Good morning, our Savior. Good morning, good morning. Happy Sunday. Welcome to worship here at our Savior. Whether you are worshiping with us online or you're here in the sanctuary, we just want to give you a warm welcome this morning. You know, one of the great things is that throughout the week, we have all sorts of things that we deal with. On a Sunday morning, we can just come to worship and we can enjoy each other. We can enjoy worshiping the Lord as a body of Christ. So let's go ahead and stand this morning as we begin our time together in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Find grace, come on now. Bet you wanna sing hallelujah. Bet you'll say amen. Can't help but celebrate being born again. Somebody who loves you is waiting at the door. It's home sweet home here in the house of the Lord. Take a load off. About to find your rest. It's a crazy world out there. Got some hope right out of the wilderness. If you're needing water for your soul, well, you're in the right place. Doesn't matter if you're rich or poor, whoever you are, this is where you find your grace. Come on now. Bet you wanna sing hallelujah. Bet you'll say the door. It's home sweet home here in the house of the Lord. Bring your burden, you can lay them down at the door. There is no fear, you belong here. Step into the house of the Lord. Bring your heartache, bring your burden, you can lay them down at the door. Ain't it so clear, you belong here. Step into the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Bet you wanna sing hallelujah. Bet you say amen. Can't help but celebrate being born again. Somebody who loves you is waiting at the door. It's home sweet home here in the house of the Lord. Bring your heart in. Bring your burdens, you can lay them down at the door. There is no fear, you belong here. Step into the house of the Lord.
No one but you. who has made the righteous bright, who has paved my way with grace. Love me through my darkest hours, a thousand different ways. No one but you. No one but you. I sing of your love. I can't get enough. I just want you. The Lord of my soul, the King of my heart, Jesus, it's you. I sing of your love. I can't get enough. I just want you. King of my heart, Jesus, is you. Hear the oceans roar, see the sky light up. Every heart now sing to the Lord. Hear the rocks cry out, see the mountains bow. Every heart come worship the Lord. Hear the oceans roar, see the skies light up. Every heart now sing to the Lord. Hear the rocks cry out, see the mountains bow. Every heart now worship the
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. You guys can sit down.
Sunday is our annual Easter egg hunt. You know, I sacrificed my body for that shot. I am still pulling wood chips out of my hands, even a week later. You know, this morning we are going to finish up our sermon series entitled Unshakable Faith. And I want to start off by sharing a word with you this morning. It's kind of an uncomfortable word. It might be a word that, you know, when you first hear it, you kind of, the word is discipline. Discipline. Have you ever noticed when it comes to discipline, you hate to see it coming, but you're glad it came? I mean, have you ever noticed that? When it comes to discipline, you hate to see it coming, but when it's gone, you're glad that it came. I mean, for instance, going to the gym. I work out at UFIT over here on 9th Street because that's where I fit in, right? And so at UFIT, you know, the hardest part about going to the gym is actually having the self-control, the discipline to get to the gym. And once you get there, once you work out, you feel good about yourself, you feel stronger, you feel healthier, you're glad you went. It takes discipline, it takes self-control in order to go. But once you go, you're glad you did it. There's kind of like this love-hate relationship when it comes to self-control, when it comes to discipline. But have you ever noticed, we have a tendency, we celebrate self-control and discipline, don't we? I mean, for instance, that time that you forewent the donut, that chocolate-covered donut, you let it go and you ate the apple instead. I mean, you felt good about yourself. You exercised some self-control. Now, as I was thinking about this, I do have one regret this past year. Have you noticed how quickly the Girl Scout cookies went away? I mean, seriously, have you noticed that they were here 1 week and then like all of a sudden they were gone? I exercised self-control. I was at Sam Clubs a couple of weeks ago, and there was a wall of Girl Scout cookies with these little temptresses trying to tempt you to buy them, and I didn't buy any. I had self-control. I walked away from it, and that was the last Girl Scout cookie I saw. I ate one box of Girl Scout cookies this year, just one box. I normally consume like 8 to 12 boxes, but this year I had one box. I never had a Thin Mint, so if anybody can get me the hookup, I've never had a Thin Mint or a Samoa this year, so I need your help. But have you ever noticed, when it comes to self-control, when it comes to discipline, motive and attitude are unrelated to outcome. I mean, this is what I mean by that, okay? If you eat clean, okay, if you eat healthy, you eat clean, you're going to reap all the benefits of eating clean, all right? You're going to have all of the good benefits, whether you have a bad attitude or a good attitude about eating clean, right? So our motive and our attitude is not correlated to the outcome. If you do it, you still have a good outcome. And have you ever noticed with many things in life, what oftentimes starts off as an ought to can develop into a want to? What oftentimes start off as something that you're enduring, you're simply enduring it, becomes something that you enjoy. I know many people who started running. They just simply started jogging. I'm not one of them, but they started jogging. You know, and you jog for a couple of weeks, and you're doing it because, you know, you want to get healthier, you want to lose weight. It's an ought to, right? But that ought to kind of develops into something that you want to do, something that you enjoy doing. And so oftentimes what starts off as being sheer discipline, a sheer ought to, oftentimes over time becomes a habit, which becomes a lifestyle, which becomes life-changing and even life-preserving at times. So what starts off as an ought to becomes something that you enjoy, something that's beneficial for you. And here's the rub, though. When it boils down to it, here's the rub. Discipline requires delayed gratification. And you know what delayed gratification is. Delayed gratification is doing what you ought to do now so that you can do what you want to do later. So this morning, we're in a sermon series called Unshakable Faith. And the question over the last 5 weeks is, how do we get unshakable faith? You know, that faith that no matter what life throws at you, that faith that no matter what storm comes your way, that you can stand firm on the promises of God. That even though your life seems like it's spinning out of control, you know that God is still in control. I mean, we all know those kind of people, right? You know that individual who's got the unshakable faith that no matter what struggle, no matter what horror was going on in their life, they held on tight. They held on firm to Christ and to his promises. And so over the last couple of weeks, we've been taking a look, how do we obtain or how do we grow and hold on to that unshakable faith? Well, this morning I want to start with Jesus. He was speaking in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, where Jesus said, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all of these things that we worry about on a day-to-day basis shall be added unto you as well." Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Now, have you ever noticed all throughout Scripture, when Jesus was talking to people, Jesus always invited people to follow me. He always said, follow me. Not just simply believe in me, but Jesus said, follow me. Watch how I live. Watch how I interact. Do what I do. In other words, Jesus calls us to be disciples. There's a difference between a believer and a disciple. A believer believes, a believer has everlasting life. A disciple sits at the master's feet, they learn all that they can possibly learn, and then they go out and do the work. See, Jesus calls us to follow him. Jesus calls us to discipleship. Jesus calls us to this active, gritty, real world kind of faith. He wants us to have this big, in spite of bold faith in a big God, and that we live it out in our world day to day. See, once again, Jesus wants us to live out loud, to live our faith out. It's more than just simply believe in me. Now, don't get me wrong. I mean, St. Paul boldly proclaims, for we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. That word justified means we've been declared innocent. Our sin, our guilt has been washed away. We have the gift of everlasting life, not because of what we've done, but all because of what Jesus has given and done for us. You and I have the promise, the hope, the assurance of everlasting life because Jesus died upon a cross and because he rose again. It's got nothing to do with how we live out our life. As long as we have faith, as long as we believe in him, we have everlasting life. But Jesus called us to more than simply just believe in him. He says, follow me. Because see, I'll maintain that if you just kind of have this head knowledge, this head faith, and you don't live it out in your day-to-day kind of life, that head faith can be fragile. And when the storms of life come, and my friends, once again, they will come sooner or later. If it's just a head faith that's not lived out on a day-to-day kind of basis, that faith may be frail and may be weak. Just the opposite. Jesus calls us to this deep, abiding, active, living kind of faith. I mean, we all know somebody, right, who when the storms of life hit them, and they couldn't explain what was going on, and they were hurt or whatever was going on in their life. We all know people who fell away, maybe even walked away from God. See, I'll maintain that faith is a lot like a muscle, okay? And an unexercised muscle begins to atrophy. It begins to get weak and even die. And what oftentimes happens when people just have a head faith and they don't live it out in their day-to-day kind of life, when the storms of life hit, they say something like, well, I'm not sure that I believe that anymore. Or they might say something like, well, I'm just not sure that that's true anymore. And they end up falling away or walking away from God. See, a couple of weeks ago, I challenged you with this. How would you respond if you were confident? If you were absolutely, positively certain that you were sure, how would you respond if you were confident that Jesus is Lord and that God is with you? I mean, this is where the rubber hits the road. In other words, if you were confident that God was with you, how would you respond to people differently than you're responding now? How would you react to people? What would you initiate? What would you avoid? If you were absolutely positively certain that God was with you, what conversation would you have with somebody? Who would you forgive? Who would you ask forgiveness from? See, the question is this. What would you do? I mean, what would you be doing differently if you were confident that Jesus is Lord and that God was with you? See, over the last couple of weeks, we've been asking the question, what facilitates the development of active, enduring faith? I mean, what is it that we need to be doing so that we can have that unshakable kind of faith? So when the storms hit, we can have the peace and the joy knowing that God is in control. And so this morning, I'm going to hit you with some very practical kind of things, right? These are the essential ingredients to having that unshakable kind of faith. And what I love about these is that they apply to you no matter what your life stage is, whether you are young or whether you are older. These will apply to you. And the first one we talked about was practical teaching. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago, that when somebody finally opens up the scripture to you in such a way that you say, oh, now I understand how it applies to my life here in St. Petersburg, Florida in 2022. Now I know what step I should be doing. Now I know how I should be living. I mean, they open the scripture up to you in such a way that it applies to you, and you say, okay, this is what I can glean from this. This is how I can live it out. Okay, we also said personal ministry or serving. You might not have all of the answers. You might not be that familiar with scripture, but when you step out in Jesus' name and serve and use the gifts and the talents and the abilities that God has blessed you with, when you have the courage, the self-discipline, the self-control to step out of the boat and to live for Christ, once again, God's at work. It creates that faith in us. I also think providential relationships is important. A providential relationship is God putting those people speaking into your lives at just the right time. I mean, think back. Do you know those providential relationships in your life? I mean, I automatically, three people came to my mind. One was a Dr. Mossman. He was a professor at Concordia University in Ann Arbor, Michigan. I never even had the man for a class. I walked into his office one time, and I was a young kid, and I remember I spent about 10 minutes with him, and he changed the entire trajectory of my life in about 10 minutes. I mean, he had such an impact on me. And you know what? The man never knew it. I think of my buddy Bob Van Hoos, who's with the Lord right now. Bob Van Hoos was one of those providential relationships where he was continually speaking into my life, encouraging me and giving me direction. I think of Dr. Bugler, who was a pastor up in Ohio, who once again was a mentor and spoke into my life. These are the relationships that God puts into our lives of those individuals who speak to us. You see, I said this before. When our act of faith, okay, when you do something, when you're living love, you're living it out, when our act of faith intersects with God's faithfulness, our faith grows. When we have the courage to step out of the boat and to use the blessings that God has bestowed upon us and actually do something with it, on the other side of the thing, on the other side of the coin, once we see God's faithfulness at work, man, our faith grows. And so this morning, I want to share with you three different private spiritual disciplines, okay, that I think will help your faith grow. And these spiritual disciplines, they may start off as an ought to. This is something that you ought to do. But I'll maintain that over time, they begin to become something that you want to do. It starts off as sheer discipline, okay, but it turns into a lifestyle kind of change that can be life-preserving, life-changing. And so I think the key factor to these self-disciplines, okay, this key factor to growing your faith, is that we need to pre-decide to do them. Okay, now I have beat this into my kids' heads since they were little. Okay, I always told my kids, you need to decide now what you're going to do. Because when you find yourself in a particular situation, you need to already have your mind up what's right and what's wrong. All right, and so I maintain that you and I, we also need to pre-decide that we're going to follow these spiritual disciplines. We say, it might start off as a sheer discipline. It might start off as something I simply ought to be doing, that I have to be doing. But I think if we maintain it over time, it'll become a lifestyle. Okay, so we need to pre-decide. Now, I've been taught as a kid that the most important thing in life is a personal relationship with God, a personal relationship with Jesus. So my wife actually needle-pointed my priorities for me, and I have them in my office. It's the only thing my wife has ever needle-pointed in her life, correct? Okay, and she did it right when we first got married, and my priorities are this. It's God, family, job. Now, see, oftentimes people mix God and my job up, right? And so it's no. God is my personal relationship with Jesus. Okay, it's my personal relationship, and then my family, and then my job. Those are my priorities. But the number one priority in my life is a personal relationship with Jesus. Okay, that's the number one priority. And a personal relationship with Jesus means that you're connected, right? It's Jesus, thy will be done in my life right here and right now. It's that personal relationship. Okay, and when you think about our relationship with God, right, there's external and there's an internal relationship when it comes to God, right? We talked about the external. Those are the ways that you serve, the things that you do. But then you have the internal relationship. That's your relationship with God. And without a personal relationship with Jesus, okay, if we don't have that personal relationship, oftentimes our worship and our faith becomes corporate. Our faith becomes routine and cold. We just simply check the box off. It's so easy for us to become critical and cynical and judgmental as we point our finger at other people. I mean, you all know the crazy church lady, right? Okay, you know, the one that you say, I know she goes to church. I mean, I know she's a believer, but she's a snot. You know, and I sure hope her son and my daughter don't get connected, because if they ever got married, that means I'd have to spend Christmas with her, and I don't want, you know, I mean, we all know people like that, right? Where they just simply check the box because they don't have a personal relationship. See, without a personal relationship with Jesus, our faith simply becomes a label. It simply becomes a label. I think with any healthy relationship, okay, whether it's with your spouse or with a child or a grandchild, any healthy relationship, you need to put time, energy, and effort into it. You need to focus on that relationship. If you do not put the time, If you do not put the energy or the effort into a relationship, sooner or later that relationship will begin to atrophy and eventually it will die. And I think we take the same kind of principles, that the human principles, and we apply them to God as well. And so here are some spiritual disciplines for you to do, okay? Number one is daily devotion. To be in God's word on a regular basis, more than just a Sunday morning. To open up your Life Bible app and to follow a devotion or just read along in the scriptures. To open up a portals of prayer or to just simply sit down with the Bible and open it up. Okay, St. Paul boldly proclaims, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. See, the Bible is unlike any other book that you'll ever read. Because when you open up the words of scripture, it's God speaking to you. And God promises us that his Holy Spirit is at work in and through his word to strengthen our faith, to give us guidance, to give us direction. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God. The Greek word for power is dunamis. It's where we get our English word dynamite from. It's this explosive power. God's word is powerful. He says in Isaiah that so his word that goes out from his mouth, it will not return to him empty or void, but it will accomplish the purposes for which it was sent out. God's word is effective. It's efficacious. And so here's my challenge for you. My friends, if you are not doing this, I want to challenge you. Say, I'm going to follow Jesus through one of the gospels. Okay, what I want you to do is just pick one of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. Right now, we're working our way through the Gospel of Luke and read through the Bible here at Our Savior. Okay, you can jump on board right now. There's sheets in the back on the welcome desk. You can go to oursaviorfl.org, and the Bible study is right there. But just open up the Scriptures. Pick one of the Gospels, and you don't have to read the whole thing at one setting. Just read one chapter or one small part. And then get excited to the next day to see what Jesus is going to do next or where he's going. And every day, just read a portion of the scripture, excited to see how Jesus was at work. You know, I did a little side tangent. You know, have you seen The Chosen? Have you been watching The Chosen? Okay, I think it is powerful. Okay, I mean, you Google it. Google The Chosen. It's online. It's free. I think there are 3 seasons right now that are completed. It follows the life of Jesus, and it kind of gives personalities to the different disciples, and it's powerful to watch how Jesus is working. Okay, so powerful to be in God's word. And then secondly, pray. We need to be praying. I'm not just talking about reactionary prayers like, oh, God, please get me through this mess, or oh, God, please let him call me back. I mean, I'm not talking about those kind of prayers. I'm talking about like almost systematic sitting down, spending time and praying. Because when we pray, those are moments with God that God is speaking to us. Those are the times when we invite God into the details of our oftentimes messy kind of lives, right? We're saying, God, please, this is what's going on in my life. This is what I'm struggling with. This is what I need guidance and direction with. And have you ever noticed in those times, it's like God is speaking directly to you? It's interesting because it's in Matthew chapter 6. Jesus is talking. He says, but when you pray, okay, you get that? He assumes that we're going to pray. Okay, so he says, but when you pray, go into your room, not in your car. I pray all the time in my car. I pray all the time as I'm walking down the hall in the hospital. So I think we're constantly praying, right? But here Jesus is saying, but when you pray, go into your room and close the door and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Okay, I mean, in the first century, that was difficult. Houses were small. Oftentimes, there were no doors. If it was a cloth or a piece of leather. And yet, Jesus is saying, go into your room, close the door, and pray. In other words, he's saying, give your Heavenly Father some undivided attention. Some undivided attention. We're just sitting there talking with him. You know, it's like if I wasn't talking with my wife on a regular basis, what kind of relationship would we have? You want a healthy, strong relationship, you need to be talking with each other. We need to be coming before God in prayer. And I would challenge you to journal your prayers. Okay, when I journal, I just simply write down those things I pray for every day. You know, my family, my church. Then I write down the things I'm praying for that day or that week. You know, somebody who's sick or somebody who's ill or going through something. And then in the back, I will record the answers. I find, I don't do it all the time. I go through spurts. But when I journal prayer, man, I am focused. All the distractions of everything else going on around me just seem to be washed away, and I'm focused in prayer. And what's amazing is Jesus practiced what he preached. In Luke chapter 5, it says, yet the good news about him spread all the more, so that crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed by their sickness. So as Jesus was preaching and teaching, more and more people became to follow him. He became more and more popular. I mean, Jesus was a busy guy. I mean, he was in high demand. He had a lot of things to accomplish. He had to save the world in 3 years. I mean, the man was busy. And yet Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Again, the scripture says it like this in Mark. It says, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Okay, he was always going off and giving God the Father undivided attention. What's really interesting, here in Mark chapter 1, the disciples woke up. They're in the kitchen making breakfast, and they go to look, and Jesus isn't there. They go out looking for him because they had a big day ahead of them. Jesus, where are you? Why are you praying? It was the very fact that he had such a busy day that he was praying. Now, I want you to get this. Jesus, who we're following, right? We're Christians. We're followers of Jesus. Jesus, who we are following, gave his Father the first minutes of the day. And if Jesus gave his Father the first minutes of the day, we should be giving our Father the first minutes of the day. I mean, we got to have the discipline. We need to pre-decide that we're going to pray. And my friends, when we pray, when we talk to God, we have what's called attunement. Okay, it's a psychological term, but attunement means like when my wife and I talk, when Suzanne and I are talking, we're attuned to each other, right? We know what her desires are, what my wants are, what we're struggling with, what's going on in our relationship, what's going on in our world. We know what's going on. It's like our conscience is attuned to each other. Well, the same thing. When we pray to God the Father, when we're praying, we're more attuned to God's will for our life. We're more attuned to God's direction. So prayer and Bible study. Okay, here's the second one. Okay, the second private spiritual discipline I want to challenge you with this morning. And my friends, this is a faith tipping point for many people. Okay, especially for men. I think this is a faith tipping point for men. Okay, it's percentage giving. Okay, it's systematic percentage giving. And this is not a money thing. This is a faith thing. This is a confidence in God kind of thing, a trust in God. It's making sure that our priorities are set straight. It was in Matthew chapter 6 that Jesus is talking to first century Christians. Now remember, in the first century, they didn't always have food to eat. They didn't know where their clean water was always coming from. And Jesus said this, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about what your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? I mean, straight up, in all honesty, you and I, we don't worry about what we're going to eat or what we're going to drink or what we're going to wear. I mean, most of us know after this where we're going to get food. We're not worried about fresh drinking water. Well, we've got 5, 6, 10 pairs of shoes in your closet, several pairs of pants. I mean, we're not worried about these things, right? But what we are worried about is how am I going to pay for my kids' college? Or will I ever have enough money to be able to retire? Or, you know, and we have all of these worries, right? And Jesus says, don't worry about such things, for the pagans run after these things. The pagans, the unbelievers, are always asking, what if? What if this? What if that? What if? What if? What if? And Jesus says, don't worry about it, for your heavenly Father knows that you need them. I mean, what a powerful statement, isn't it? God knows what we need. But see, here's the crunch. Okay, this is the issue here, okay? Do you believe Jesus? When he says, don't worry about him, your heavenly Father knows, do you believe Jesus? Because in all honesty, it's easy for us to trust in God when everything is up and to the right. It's easy for us to trust God when everything is going well in our life. Or the reverse, it's easy for us to trust God when we're in the midst of a crisis and we can't do anything about it. I mean, when all heck is breaking loose in our life and we have absolutely positively no control, it's easy for us to throw our hands up and say, oh God, okay, I trust in you. Please take this off my... Okay, but Jesus is saying, no, I don't want you to simply trust me in that. I want you to trust me all the time. Trust me all the time because I'm with you all the time. And so when it comes to our finances, Jesus is saying, put your money where your faith is. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all of these things that we worry about on a daily basis will be given to you as well. So my friends, giving exercises our faith because it involves letting go of what we are most inclined to put our confidence in rather than God. Okay, and Jesus is saying, I want all of you. I want you, the entire person. But giving exercises our faith because it involves letting go of what we are most inclined to put our confidence in rather than God. I mean, Jesus, this was profound. Jesus said it like this. He said, no one can serve two masters. Either you'll hate the one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God. And in our church minds, right, in our Christian minds, the way you think, you can't serve both God and the devil. I mean, that would make sense, wouldn't it? Okay, you can't serve both. But straight up, our struggle isn't with it. We're not going to follow the devil. Okay, and so Jesus said, you cannot serve both God and your stuff. You can't serve both God and money. Why did Jesus say that? I mean, why was he focused on money? Because money is the number one contender for our loyalty. I mean, be honest with yourself. Our wealth, our finances, is the number one contender for our loyalty. And we'll say, you know, normally here in the States, we trust our wealth for stuff, don't we? I mean, it's hard work. I pulled myself up by the bootstraps. You want it done right? Do it yourself. And so we trust in God, or we trust in our wealth, until our wealth fails us. And then plan B, then we'll trust in God. When it comes to percentage giving, I want you to struggle with one word. And here's the word. Why? Why? I want you to think to yourself, why? Why do you put your trust, or why do you put your faith in this, rather than God? And the third spiritual discipline I want to challenge you with, so Bible reading or daily devotion, percentage giving, thirdly, corporate worship. Gathering together as a family of believers. Okay, it's corporate worship is a group dynamic that has this very personal impact, doesn't it? I mean, I can't always explain it, but when we gather together, something takes place that you don't necessarily have when you're alone. You know, when we closed down the church for those 6 weeks or so in the midst of the pandemic, you know, it came out of my mouth and it came out of the mouths of others, people saying, I miss church. And when we say I miss church, it wasn't the building. I've got keys to the building. I worked every day. I mean, I could walk in and out of the church building as much as I wanted. It wasn't the building. It was the people. It was you. We miss you. We miss each other. See, when we come together, it's a we thing. There's a we thing going on here. Jesus said it like this in Matthew chapter 18. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. Now, I can't explain all this. I mean, that's a profound statement, and I can't go into all the details, and I just can't explain all the details. But I think one thing that we do learn from this is that when we gather together, there's something that takes place that we might just miss if we were alone and not with each other. Because where two or three are gathered, when we come together, Jesus says, there I am with them. And it's here at the church, in worship, that we receive the Lord's Supper, the true body, the true blood of Christ, for the forgiveness of our sins and for the strengthening of our faith. It's here in worship that we are baptized, that God washes away our sin, calls us by name, gives us the gift of his Holy Spirit. We need each other. St. Paul writes it like this, now you are the body of Christ, and that you are, okay, that's in the second person plural, right? It kind of means that y'all, okay, y'all are the body of Christ, okay? All of us together, we are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. In other words, we need each other. We're better together. It's in worship, in church, that God is up to something bigger than us, but it includes us. It includes us. Okay, and so here's, as I wrap this up this morning, here's my challenge for you, okay? I want to give you a 30-day challenge. And I think, you know, oh, for crying out loud, not a 30-day challenge, okay? I know, okay. But here's the 30-day challenge, okay? These are private spiritual disciplines, all right? The first one is this. Give God the first minutes of your day. Give God the first dollars of your income. Give God the first day of your week. Okay, just try this for 30 days. Okay, starting today, I just want you to try it for 30 days. Give God the first minutes of your day. You don't have to give him all your minutes. Just spend a few minutes in prayer, recognizing God for who he is, recognizing God for his goodness, inviting God into the details of your life. You know what your day holds for the most part. You know when you're going to have those stressful moments or those difficult conversations. Invite God into that messiness of your day. Just spend a few minutes every day. Give God the first dollars of your income. You don't have to give God all your dollars. I'm not even telling you to give 10%. Give 2%. Just pick a percentage and systematically give. And you don't even have to give it to our Savior. Give it someplace else. But I want to challenge you to use your resources to make a difference in the lives of someone else, to build up the kingdom of God, to live love, love Jesus, love people, and serve the world. and give God the first day of the week. Doesn't have to be Sunday, but I want to challenge you, just give God one day. One day where you gather together with other people in worship. Seek first. Jesus said, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. And all of these things that we worry about will be given to you as well. Seek first. One of the ways you seek first is daily devotion and prayer. Systematic giving and corporate worship. When you talk to people who have that unshakable faith, man, those are some of the things that you see them live out. And once again, it may start off as a sheer discipline, something you have to do, something you ought to do. But it becomes a habit. It becomes a lifestyle. And then it becomes something you enjoy doing. It's that relationship. It's that intimacy with God. It continues to grow deeper and deeper and deeper. We pray with me, please. Lord, we praise you for your grace, for your love, for the goodness that you shower down upon each and every one of us over and over and over again. We did absolutely nothing to deserve it. Yet because of who you are, because of your love and goodness, we have been forgiven. We have the hope and the assurance of everlasting life. And so, Lord, we want to have that unshakable faith, that when those storms of life come and our world seems to be spinning out of control, we can stand firm on your promises and say, God is in control. We can have that joy and that peace that only you can give. And so by the power of your Spirit at work in each every one of us, may we have the discipline, may we have the self-control, Lord, to practice some of these private spiritual practices, that we can be in your word on a regular basis, that we can come before you in prayer and invite you into the messiness of our life, that we give systematically, that we give a percentage systematically, and that, Lord, we continue to join together in worship with others. Lord, be your Spirit at work in us, that our love and our faith in you grow stronger and stronger. Lord, to you be the glory, the honor, and the praise. These and all things you'd have us ask of you. We pray together in the prayer that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This is the time of the worship service that we would normally take the offering. If you are worshiping with us in-house, there is an offering basket in the back as you exit the sanctuary. If you are worshiping with us online, you can give securely at oursaviorfl.org. We have text to give, and we also have Venmo at oursaviorfl. You know, one of the things that we are going to be supporting here in the next months is many of the refugees from the Ukraine. We are working with Franklin Graham's organization, and we are also working with an orphanage that was transplanted out of the Ukraine into Poland. We've had several of our members that have gone and have visited this orphanage, and so they can see what's happening on the ground firsthand. And so we're going to be collecting monies in order to support that, and Franklin Graham's, which escapes me, give me the name. Samaritan's Purse, which is a powerful, powerful ministry. Samaritan's Purse is already on the ground and has been in Poland as well. And so if you'd like to make a special donation to Samaritan's Purse or to that orphanage, you can do so. Just mark it Live Love Ukraine, and every penny that you give will be given directly to those two organizations. And with all that, will you please rise? Let's continue our worship.
the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a change. To take their place with selfless faith.